And in English, people usually translate salah as prayer. Prayer does not denote the complete meaning of the Arabic word salah. Because to pray means to ask for help, to beseech. How do you pray in a court of law? You beseech, you ask for help. In our salah, besides asking for help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are also praising Him, and at the same time we receive guidance from Him. Prayer does not denote the complete meaning of salah. To pray means only to ask for help. In our salah, besides asking for help, we praise Him and we also receive guidance from Him. If you ask me to explain, I would say that salah is a sort of programming, a sort of conditioning. But if someone asks, where are you going? And if I say I'm going for programming, it will sound odd. Therefore, I've got no objection if someone uses the word prayer, English word prayer, for explaining salah. But just let me make a point clear to you that prayer does not denote the complete meaning of the Arabic word salah. Why do I say that salah is a sort of programming? Because we are being guided in our salah. For example, after the imam, after he reads Surah Fatiha, he may recite Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 90 of the glorious Quran, which says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you believe, innamal khamru wal maisuru, most certain intoxicants and gambling, or anzabu wal azlamu, dedication of stones, divination of arrows, rushtum min amali shaitan, these are Satan's handiwork, fashtanibu lalukum tuflihun, abstain from this handiwork that you may prosper. Here we are being guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by Almighty God, that intoxicants, gambling, idol worshipping, fortune telling, these are Satan's handiwork. Abstain from this handiwork that you may prosper. We are being programmed in our salah. We are being guided in our salah. We are being conditioned. The Imam may recite Surah Al-Baqarah chapter 2, verse 188, which says that spend not your wealth on vanities, and not spend your wealth as a bait to judges, in order that you may eat up somebody else's property. The Quran says that bribing is not allowed in Islam. You are being programmed, you are being conditioned that bribing is wrong. The Quran says in Surah An-Kabut, chapter 29, verse 45, Utlu ma uhiya ilayka min al-kitabi wa aqimus salata inna salata tanha anil fashai wal munkar. That recite of what we have revealed to thee of the book, and establish regular prayers. For verily, prayers restrain you from shameful and unjust deeds. The Quran says that prayer restrains you from shameful and unjust deeds. And every Muslim is supposed to offer salah minimum 5 times a day. How? For a healthy body, you have to have 3 meals a day. Similarly, for a spiritual soul, you should offer salah minimum 5 times a day. And the glorious Quran says in Surah Taha, chapter number 20, verse number 11 and 12, that when he approached the fire, he heard a voice, O Moses, verily I am thy Lord. Put off thy shoes, for thou art in the sacred valley of Tuah. Almighty God commanded Moses to remove his shoes because he was in a sacred place. A similar message is given in the Bible, in the Old Testament, in the book of Exodus, chapter number 3, verse number 5. It says that draw not nigh hither, put off thy shoes from thy feet, for the place where thou standest is holy ground. The same message repeated in the book of Acts, chapter number 7, verse number 33. Almighty God tells Moses, draw not nigh hither, put off thy shoes from thy feet, for the place where thou standest is holy grounds. It was a commandment given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to Prophet Moses, peace be upon him, that in holy ground, in sacred place, while offering worship, remove your shoes. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he gave us permission for both. You should pray without your footwear, but if you are praying with your footwear, you should see that the footwear is clean. And the Prophet said, it's mentioned in Abu Dawud, volume number 1, in the book of Salah, chapter number 240, Hadith number 652. The Prophet said, they do the opposite of what the Jews do, because they always prayed without shoes and sandals. It's mentioned Abu Dawud, volume number 1, in the book of Salah, chapter 240, Hadith number 653, that Shuayb ibn Amr, on the authority of his father, said that his grandfather said that I have seen the Prophet pray both barefooted and with sandals. That means a Muslim can pray without shoes. And if he prays with shoes, the Prophet said, you should clean the soul, because we're hygienic people. We want to keep the place of worship clean. And the glorious Quran says in Surah Maidah, chapter number 5, verse number 6, that Ya ayyuhal lazina amunu, all you who believe, when you appear for prayers, when you prepare yourself for prayers, wash your face and your hands up to the elbow. Rub your head with water and wash your feet up to the ankle. Doing ablution wudu before we offer salah is compulsory for the Muslims. And a similar message is given if you read the Bible. It's mentioned in the book of Exodus, chapter number 40, verse number 31 and 32, that Moses and Aaron, along with the son, they washed their hands and feet thereat. And when they entered the temple of congregation, they washed before they appeared in front of their Lord. It's mentioned in Acts, chapter number 21, verse number 26, that Paul, along with the men, the next day, washed and appeared in front of the Lord. Doing ablution is a requirement, because we Muslims, we are hygienic people. We want to be clean. And besides that, it's a mental preparation. It's a mental preparation. How you have prelim before the finals, it's a mental preparation before you appear in front of your Lord. If Christian is a person who follows the teachings of Jesus, peace be upon him, if Christian is a person who follows the teachings of Jesus, peace be upon him, then we Muslims, we are more Christian than the Christians themselves, because we follow more of the Bible. While offering salah, as the Bible says, we do ablution. Further, our beloved Prophet said, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, in the book of Adhan, chapter 75, Hadith number 692, that Hazrat Anas, may Allah be pleased with him, he said that when the companions offered salah, our shoulders touched with the shoulders of the companions, our feet touched with the feet of the companion. And the beloved Prophet further said, it's mentioned in Abu Dawud, volume number 1, in the book of Salah, chapter number 245, Hadith number 666, the Prophet said before offering salah that straighten your rows, stand shoulder to shoulder, do not leave any gap, close in the gap, and do not leave any opening for the devil. The Prophet wasn't referring to the devil, which you see in the comic strip with two horns and a tail. The Prophet was referring to the devil of racism, of caste, of color. That irrespective whether you're rich or poor, whether you're king or pauper, when you stand for salah, stand shoulder to shoulder. Irrespective whether you're black or white, brown or yellow, when you stand for salah, stand shoulder to shoulder. This is the teaching of beloved Prophet. And the best part of salah is the sujood, is the prostration. And the psychologists tell us that our mind is not directly under our control. Our body is directly under our control. If I want to lift my hand, I can lift my hand. If I want to bring it down, I can bring it down. If I want to take a step forward, I can take a step forward. If I want to take it backwards, I can take it backwards. Body is directly under my control. But the mind keeps on wandering. It's not directly under my control. The psychologists say, in order to humble the mind, you have to humble the body. And there's no better way than putting the highest part of the body, that the forehead, on the lowest part of the ground, and then say, glory be to Allah, the Most Highest. Glory be to Allah, the Most Highest. And the same method has been prescribed even in the Bible, in the Old Testament as well as New Testament. If you read the book of Genesis, chapter number 17, verse number 3, it says that Abraham fell on his face. In the book of Numbers, chapter number 20, verse number 6, Moses and Aaron fell upon their faces. In the book of Joshua, chapter number 5, verse number 14, Joshua fell on his face and did worship. It's mentioned in the New Testament. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, when he goes in the Garden of Gethsemane, in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 26, verse number 39, it says that Jesus took a few steps forward, fell on his face and prayed to thy Lord. I am asking a question, even an acrobat cannot do better, fall on the face and pray to God, than the way we Muslims do. It's the same way. How Jesus, peace be upon him, prayed. So if following the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, makes a person a Christian, then we Muslim are more Christian than the Christian.